I will be totally authentic, which was one of the goals of communication of this commission. And because I really feel what I'm talking about, it's not something a theoretical thing. And I also believe that I can give you some relevant information, and you will see why. And the first reason why is the question of translation and what the words mean. And sort of the inspiration for this presentation comes from this. When I was translating using, I don't know, Google, something like that, Google Translate, giving the sound, the word in English that appeared to me was dissemination, which for me is not the same. Dissemination, divulgação, e disseminação in Portuguese are two different words, and for me they really mean different things. And the dissemination we were talking about this morning is more or less this kind of dissemination. And for me, the way my own experience as a practitioner is that dissemination is something with an added value, and I will talk about it. And I really will talk about three levels of dissemination. Being the first one that we talked about this morning, the first one. So I, and for me the most relevant ones are the second and the third. So this is important because we are dealing not only with reading documents in other from other origins, but also having to do interviews. This may be an issue, an important question, and in this sense that I was telling you that this may be relevant. Because if you are preparing an interview using words that don't have the same meaning to the people who are there being interviewed, it can lead to misleading interpretation. That's why I thought maybe it's not. We could just stay and rest, but I believe that there may be some relevant information. I hope, at least. If it isn't, you tell me, please. You just say, Clara, shut up. Okay. I would like to present you with a conversation that has these four topics. First, I will just in a very short way tell you what the pan sector in Portugal is, and we will raise some of the challenges that this sector is dealing with. And I put there emerging sector faces, because it's not just the pan sector, and this will be important for what comes after. What is the pan? The project, the process, the model, this one with an interrogation time, and then disseminating a pan, the concepts of dissemination and also the product. And I will talk to you about how I feel about both dissemination and product. And in the end, we'll talk, we'll debate a little on social innovation, dissemination, the relation between them, and sustainability. So my proposition for us is that any time when one of the topics finish, we would share some ideas that came into our minds when we heard about this, relating to your research. So we will raise questions in every of these steps, okay? So that you won't feel asleep. You won't be able to. Okay. Do you agree with the palm sector in Portugal? Maybe you have already, some of you, seen this, some of the presentations that I've done many. I've disseminated it a lot now. The first concept of dissemination. Well, but PAM is a very, is a very wide concept, because there's a lot inside this concept. There's different plants, different products, different processes, different industries. We have different business models. You can grow it and sell it fresh. You can dry it, you can distill it. You can sell it on bulk, in bulk, or package it, or transform. And when you transform, there are lots of different industries that are related to these products as raw materials. Thank you. Well, in fact, it's such a diversity that it would be quite impossible to say that we are addressing palm sector. So, what I've been working mostly with EPA is mainly with products that are dried and also that are distilled. So I'm not working with the ones that sell fresh. Well, you know that Portugal, like Greece, like the example we saw in Stevia, or Stevia is also grown in Portugal. We are in a Mediterranean basin hotspot, so it means that there's a big diversity in terms of flora, and there are climate and soil conditions that are special and that allow us to grow plants that cannot be grown in other countries in Europe, in Central Europe. This is a comparative advantage, and it's not only related to the plants that we have locally, not only the autochthonous plants, but also we have good conditions like the stevia to grow plants that are not that are from other places on Earth. So we can compete with other countries. And an additional top information is that it is in Portugal a very recent agricultural option. It is quite related with the crisis and this new rurals movement. I usually say that I'm an old rural, because I went from the city to the rural place almost 30 years ago, but now for the past 10 years many people are doing this. We call them the new rural. I don't know if it's a concept anywhere else, but and so being a new sector, there's knowledge, equipment, structures, stakeholders, economic relevance, etc. That can be a problem for those who are now settling in this sector.
And can I have one specified question? I tried to ask in the evening, but I'm going to ask about this. About, like, when you speak in this context about new rurals, or when you speak about the new rurals movement in Portugal, does it imply people in the agriculture or also in other fields?
It mostly come from other fields. Okay. They have not an agricultural background.
Okay.
And it puts additional difficulties on starting with the activity.
No, but let's say the businesses that they start, or let's say when you speak about new rurals that do something or rest of the countryside, do they then engage mostly with agriculture or
most of them come from the city. Just come from the city.
Yeah, but like let's say when they even come to the rural areas and start new businesses, the businesses that they start, are they mostly in the field of agriculture or also in other fields?
Well, those who are settling in this sector, they are there for agricultural reasons. This is in Portugal. There, I believe, not only there. There's financial support for young farmers, and most of them decide to become a farmer also because they have this special support. So they go from the city directly to agricultural activities, and most of them, some of them also have a complementary activity, but there are many who just do this. In this case, we are talking of non-traditional farmers. They totally are different from the farmers that we usually have in Portugal. These are very, very small companies, only 1-2 hectares in the median in this sector. Organic, export-oriented, young and highly educated, and one very important